little more shall my teacup so generous be in filling the cups with this pernicious tea. For I'll fill it with water and drink out the same before I lose liberty, that dearest name.
We are very pleased to welcome our friends from the Boston Tea Party Ships and Museum for a program entitled And One for the Pot. In this program, we will learn about tea in colonial America, from its journey halfway across the world to colonial brewing techniques, and finally, the social and political place this commodity held. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guests, Dorothy Quincy and Dorothy Wendell Skinner.
Welcome, everyone, to our fine afternoon here together. It's a pleasure to have you here. As was mentioned already, we will be brewing a little bit of tea for you and bringing some news from the streets of Boston.
Cousin, dear, I have missed your company. In fact, I have a bit of news about the Sons of Liberty that I've learned from my father's study.
I am very much looking forward to that. But first, we should introduce ourselves a little more thoroughly to the good people joining
us here. Yes, an excellent idea. Friends, my name is Miss Dorothy Quincy, daughter of Justice Edmund Quincy from Braintree, though all my dear friends do call me Dolly.
Now, my name is Dorothy Wendell. I'm the daughter of John Wendell. I'm also married to Dorothy Wendell Skinner, actually. My mother, on the other hand, is a Quincy. She is the sister of dear Dorothy's father, meaning we are first cousins. Mm-hmm. And as we're both named Dorothy, you can call me Dot.
Yes, Dolly and Dot. I know, it sounds quite a bit confusing. But more importantly, we are having tea here amidst this crisis in town. Now, tea is the social beverage of the 18th century. Serving it is a sign of politeness and hospitality. Drinking it is a custom with distinctive manners and special equipment.
The use of tea grows upon me surprisingly. It awakens my fancy, ooh, and my spirits are exhilarated as if with wine.
Ooh, my goodness.
Now, tea, this most mysterious plant, is grown in the Wuyi Mountains in China. After the tea is harvested and dried, it's packaged into tall bundles, somewhat like a bale of hay, supported by a big, tall pole, reaching much higher than a man. Mm-hmm. The tea is transported down from the mountains by the man wearing this big pack on his back. The pole is there so that when he is heading down the mountain, which is a several-day journey, he can lean the pole against a tree and rest his weight on the pack without having to let the tea leaves ever touch the ground.
And the journey down the mountain finally reaches a river. There, men will load the tea into boats called junks, and they'll sail down the river to Canton. That's the port where the East India Company will package their tea. Men called bundlers will package this tea by taking the loose leaf tea and placing it into crates. Then they'll use their bare feet to stamp the tea down into the crates, making sure they are tightly packed. And loose leaf tea is how we would most commonly serve our tea here in Boston, and it looks a little bit like this.
Now, once the tea was packaged into these crates in Canton, it became the duty of the East India Company merchants to be able to bring it all the way to England and then to the rest of the English-speaking world. The East India Company merchants will put this tea onto ships that will then sail round past the Cape of Good Hope all the way along the African coast and up to England, where it is then repackaged into new crates. These are wooden crates with a lead lining along the inside to keep the tea waterproof and safe for drinking and give that nice taste that lead always gives to your foodstuffs. And then the crates are wrapped in a canvas wrapping and stamped with the merchant's mark of the East India Company. From there, they're held, ooh, in a warehouse in London for as long as it takes until they have to send them along their way.
Dot, the English weren't even the first to bring tea here to the colonies. It was the Dutch.
You're joking.
No, in fact, the Dutch East India Company is quite an enemy of our English East India Company. It is said that New Amsterdam, you may now know this as the colony of New York, the Dutch East India Company director actually wrote of bringing tea here in 1647. tea was not brought to English coffee houses in London until 1658. That's a whole 10 years later.
We drank it here first, that's right. Now, however, for England and the English-speaking world, the East India Company is the only legal merchant we're allowed to buy from. The East India Company now has a monopoly on the tea trade for all of England. So, and this means that in order to find alternatives to having to buy East India Company tea, some merchants, both in England and in the colonies, merchants like Mr. John Hancock, who's quite caught Miss Quincy's fancy here, they will smuggle tea in from the Dutch East India Company or other European nations, so they don't have to pay a tax to England or Holland or Portugal or wherever the tea is coming from. Huzzah!
Well, and tell them about what happened in 1770.
Oh, that's right. Now, Boston has had a little bit more trouble establishing strong trade routes to Holland, and so the smuggling has not taken off quite as much as it has in our sister colonies. In the year 1770, so that's just 3 years ago, New York City imported only 147 pounds of tea in weight.
For the whole year,
that was legal tea being imported that was marked in their books. Every other cup of tea they drank that year was made from smuggled tea. That same year, Philadelphia imported only 65 pounds 65. Of legal tea, whereas that same year in Boston, there was imported a total of 50,000 pounds of legal tea just through the houses of the two most prominent merchant families, those of the Clarks and the Hutchinsons.
And so, no matter where you're getting your tea from, the Dutch or the English, this is all the same tea from China.
True.
In fact, the best teas are picked right before the rains in April. They are green tea, and the word haizong in Chinese actually means newest and smallest leaf. That's where we get our finest green tea, the Heisen tea. Singlo is a good alternative to a green tea, though it is a bit more expensive. It does come from the Sunglo Mountains in China, and it has a very poor shelf life, expiring very quickly. So you might want to stick to your Heisen if you can.
Now, if you are a fan of black tea, the most common, popular, and typically the cheapest black tea available in the colonies is called Bohe, sometimes pronounced Boohe. This is a note for the name of the Wuyi Mountains, where the tea is grown. Now, this is a black tea. In the days of our grandmother, Bohe was a very finely crafted tea, delicately rolled into pleasant little leaves before it was shipped to us. However, in the last few decades, the East India Company has felt the need to mass produce this tea, especially for all of the middle and lower class tea drinkers who have now caught on to enjoying the beverage. And so what's sold to us as Bohe these days is just the leaves of plants stripped from the stalk, dried and crumpled up into crates.
Oh. Well, that's probably why grandmother always told us to get konju if you can. Konju is a bit more of an expensive black tea. Also available would be the souchong. Now, souchong has a bit of a smoky aroma to its leaves. For when the man who is bringing the leaves down the mountain is resting on his back on the pole, there's normally a campfire around, and the smoke starts to permeate these leaves. So when you are drinking some souchong tea, you can smell the smoky aroma as you're drinking it.
It's a bit like drinking a boiled log. Not exactly my cup of tea.
No.
Perhaps we should share some tea, brew a little bit for us.
That's an excellent idea. Now, as we are not at our own homes, we have had to improvise quite a bit. But we have here for you today our tea set we have comprised together, and we'll explain each thing and hold it up for you.
Now, the most important thing to keep in mind when brewing a good cup of 18th century English tea is to use very, very hot water, freshly boiled from a kettle. Now, this is a silver teapot, which were commonly being used at the time. We will pretend it is our kettle at the moment. Now, you're not going to pour your hot tea directly into the teapot that you're going to be drinking from and brew right away, because this is made of a cold stoneware or porcelain, and thus it's going to chill your water right as it's poured in. So first, I'll take a bit of water from the kettle, just a splash, and pour it into the pot. And Dolly, if you would be so kind. She's swirling the water around inside the pot so it coats all along the inside of the ceramic, warms it up, and that way your tea won't be chilled as it's brewing. Once the pot is warmed, you can pour out the excess water into a little dish.
Excellent.
Beautiful. And now we will add dry tea leaves directly to the pot.
Now this is our tea caddy. Dot has brought it in for us. You'll notice that it's made of porcelain and on the cover has a nice scene from China. Now blue was very popular at this time, as were other colors such as yellow or red, like on our No Stamp Act teapot we've brought with us. So why don't we do one scoop of tea for you, Dot.
Thank you.
One scoop of tea for me, and
One for the pot. Now, this is loose leaf tea, and you might be wondering, won't that get mixed into my cup as I'm pouring it out? Well, you might get a little bit of the loose tea coming out into your tea cup, and the tea bag is not yet a practice that has come into play.
So, put your tea in a bag.
It's like a pudding. much rather, you would have your loose leaves into the pot, and you would pour hot water directly onto the loose leaves. Often teapots will have a little strainer just at the base of the spout of the pot so that it will filter out some of the leaves as it's being poured. But you can also use a small slotted spoon called a moat spoon after you've poured out your cup of tea to skim the leaves that are floating from the top of the cup, and then you can rinse your moat spoon in any of the discarded water you have off to the side.
Oftentimes, if you have any leaves that get caught in the spout of your teapot, a moat spoon comes with a pointed end, very pointy, and you can stick it in the end of your spout and discharge any of the obstruction that is obstructing your teapot.
That way you don't have to do anything highly unsociable like sticking your fingers into the spout or picking it up and blowing on it like a trumpet.
Oh, no. Now, I've told you about our tea caddy. You can take this right to the shop, perhaps of Richard Clark & Sons or the Hutchinson Boys, get some tea purchased. Most caddies will hold about a pound and a third of tea.
Often a bit larger than
this.
And while they are sometimes made of fine ceramics and earthenwares, you would also often see for caddies owned by middling and lower class women, frequently wood, and sometimes with a little bit of a sliding lid that you can carry along with you.
Now your caddy would also be placed, if you are wealthy enough, in a tea chest at home. They have a very sturdy lock on them. And the woman of the house would have the key to this lock, making sure that none of your servants are trying to steal a bit of your very expensive tea that you've paid quite a bit of money for.
Sticky fingers. Now, tea chests, these are not the same kinds of chests that were originally packaged on the ships and brought the tea to us from London, or the tea from China to London. Much rather, these are very fancy, highly ornate pieces of furniture meant to be on display, but also, since it's got that lock on it, not necessarily touched. Sometimes in inventories, there are the tea chests are some of the most expensive things in the estates that are listed. Often when you open the chest, especially amongst the finer ones, which are gilded, painted, trimmed, and carved all along the outside, there will be three spaces on the inside of the chest. You will have a caddy for green tea, a caddy for black tea, and in the middle, a caddy for sugar.
Ooh. Now, we've mentioned that our tea is loose leaf tea coming from China. Brick tea was not quite popular here in the colonies, though it was used as currency over in Russia and Mongolia. Now, this tea had to be wet in order to be pressed into a brick form, so the tea itself has already been used. Once you get the tea leaves wet, that flavor starts to drain out of it. So it's not quite the best tea that you would have if you were purchasing brick tea.
Not to mention the practice of drinking brick tea in Central Asia is not nearly the same as our English style. It's often made with yak's milk.
Oh, goodness. this has been steeping for about 3 minutes now. We'll let it do a few more minutes.
You want to give your tea a time to steep, normally about 3 to 5. We've got a black tea here today, so we're going to let it go a little bit longer, but not so long that it gets overly bitter. Now, to mention sugar as well, we should chat about that since that's inside the tea chest.
This is our sugar bowl here.
Now, sugar and tea have risen in popularity incredibly, hand in hand throughout the 18th century. Mm-hmm. In fact, as the demand for tea has grown and the need for it to be accessible to as many people and very inexpensive, you also have a greater need for widely spread and inexpensive means of sweetening your tea.
Most people don't have a taste for tea without any sugar in it, as it is quite bitter. But we have some granulated white sugar here with us today. Some people who don't have access to this sugar, as it can be expensive coming from the West Indies and the Caribbean, many people will put honey in their tea, perhaps if you have a comb in your backyard. Sugar normally comes conically shaped, and you can shave off a bit of sugar, or you can get it in a sugar bowl loose as the granules start to fall apart.
Of course, finer white sugar that would come off of the cone or crumple very easily into fine granules would be amongst the most expensive, very refined. As you get through the brown sugars and down into the byproducts of the refining process, you get a little bit more inexpensive. Occasionally, people will sweeten their tea with molasses, but as molasses has a very strong and unique flavor, I highly recommend if you put a drop in, try it with a black tea, something like a souchong that's got a powerful enough flavor of its own that it's not going to be completely overpowered by the strong molasses. You might also use treacle, which is another byproduct of the distilling process. As tea, as sugar makes its way from the sugar cane plant all the way to something, say, as far-fetched as rum, there are many byproducts along the way, and treacle is a thick, syrupy, a bit viscous like honey, brownish syrup made in the process, and rather more inexpensive if you're one of the middle class ladies brewing a cup of tea.
Now you'll notice that our teacups are of different variety. Normally a woman would bring a teacup with her. You could have a silk pouch, perhaps with a spoon in your teacup. Most women wouldn't have a matching set of 6 or 7 cups for their friends to come and join them for some tea. So you could bring your own cup and your own spoon, and we have done that here today.
Now, many of these tea wares are made in China. In fact, it's considered to be the very best of tea wares that would be imported from China by the East India Company along with tea. However, they break very, very, very often in the shipping.
And most porcelain that is shipped to us here in America, by the time it has made it all the way here after passing through London, some will have chips on them, or they cannot resell any chipped cups or broken teapots as well. You wouldn't want to pay for that. Damaged goods.
Now, English merchants and English craftsmen are very well aware of this demand for Chinese goods, and so they've been trying to mimic some of the Asian and Chinese practices of making these tea wares. However, they haven't quite got the knack of it. They have produced some very fine earthenware and stoneware things in England, and the colonies have rather a bit of a pride for silverware tea goods as well.
Red clay pots are found as well here in the colonies, but more or less the porcelain would have to be imported from China, or you could use a silver teapot. Perhaps Mr. Revere could send us one.
He makes a good one. You can see your face in it. Now, our teapot we have here, which emblazoned with the words "No Stamp Act," did come a common symbol during our boycotts against the Stamp Act taxes of 1765. However, as patriotic and American as this sort of symbol is, I am sorry to say that a good many of these teapots were not made in the colonies, but rather in a teapot manufacturing area in Derby, England, as they sold them to us because we ate them up like hotcakes and our attempts were a good American protest.
Perhaps it's time we pour a little bit of this tea, shall
Certainly.
We?
Certainly.
How do you take your tea, my dear?
I will take, you can pour it in. I think since this is a black tea, I'll take a little bit of cream in my tea and a good amount of sugar.
Oh, good. I will have a little bit as well.
Now, as for cream or milk, you would not want to add cream or milk to a green tea, as it's a milder flavor. It can become overpowered with the dairy aspect to it. But if you've got a good strong black tea, thank you, dear, You can add a little splash of it, and this will often tamper the bitterness and make it a little more sweet and palatable. However, you will really only want to add cream, milk, or any sort of dairy to your tea if you have a very fresh source.
Oh, yes.
And there's not really a way to keep milk or dairy or cream cold. If you have your own dairy cow at your disposal, you can have servants bring along some cream or milk to your table.
Excellent.
Thank you, dear.
I put a lot of sugar in. All right, very good.
Now, let's see. Of course, beautiful. Now, you might be wondering, is anyone hungry during tea time? Now, frequently you'll dine during breakfast. You will have some tea with your breakfast. You may also have tea at the end of the day after you've had dinner. Now, dinner is typically served around 2 or 3 in the afternoon, so you're finishing dining at about 3 or 4, and especially if you're amongst the upper classes, as the sun's going down, you might be able to enjoy a little bit of leisure time. The men will start to imbibe some of their stronger spirits, and ladies will often retire to have a cup of tea. Mm-hmm. If you are not completely stuffed and want a little food to go along with it, you needn't have any cakes or cookies or special little treats that are highly sweetened.
Plenty of sugar.
The sugar in our tea is quite enough. You will often find on English tea drinkers' tables in the 18th century a plate of toasted bread with butter. Mm-hmm. Simple and satisfying.
You'll notice that our teacups have tiny little handles, though this is a rather new commodity on teacups. Normally, you would find tea dishes or bowls, and women would drink either in a variety of ways of holding their tea dish as such, or you can hold it the other way, whatever way suits your fancy, though these tiny little handles do seem to help with a hot teacup. Now, you've heard of pinky out, I suppose. It's not quite to be pretentious. If you wear it too out, then you just look silly. It's for balance. Make sure that you've got your pinky slightly out as you're drinking your tea, and then sip. Oh, it's very strong.
Beautiful.
Now, tea is often found in coffee houses at this time. Inside a coffee house, you can get the trifecta of beverages of tea, coffee, or cocoa. Not quite the same cocoa that you're thinking. It's very bitter. You can also sample a selection of liquors or ciders, ales. However, coffee houses cater mainly to men. You wouldn't find a woman inside a coffee house. It's not inside a woman's domestic sphere. But perhaps your brother will bring us back a little bit of tea from the Green Dragon when he comes back.
Oh, Dolly, I like to sample my tea before purchasing. You never know what you're going to enjoy.
True.
If a lady here in the colonies does want to enjoy a cup of tea, she can take her caddy to one of the merchant's shops. Now, our cousins in England have the luxury of being able to ride their carriages right up to the front door of Twinings on the Strand in London, where all of their finest teas will be laid out for them, and they are often allowed to pick their individual varieties of tea, have a sample brewed, and test it to make sure that they can bring home the very best.
Oh, nice.
But here in Boston, we will have to stick with the houses of Hutchinson and Clark, where they procure the finest teas for us. While it gives me a chance to pick the tea that best suits my taste, it is also a very fun social opportunity for everyone involved as well.
Speaking of social occasions, Dot and I normally find ourselves in the tea room chatting away as we used to when we were young girls. Mm-hmm. However, our conversations have been changing as of late, and I do like to think that it has something to do with this tea on our table. For you see, we're sampling this tea in these porcelain dishes from China, drinking tea often on a lacquered or japanned tea table from Japan, drinking with some sugar from the West Indies. We have become global consumers. Normally, tea wouldn't be grown here in the colonies. The weather doesn't allow for it. So we have now become women who are drinking and utilizing objects from all corners of God's creation.
This tiny little corner of New England has been opened up to an entire world of opportunities. However, now, those same ships that bring all of the tea and all of the imported goods into town also bring news from areas like England, other European nations, and even further away.
Mm.
Not to mention, Dolly, have you heard about the changes that have happened in the tea trade recently?
I suppose you're talking about that new tea act that was passed earlier this year.
Aye, yes indeed. Now, earlier this year, Parliament passed a revision of the Tea Act, a way to change up the tax on tea. Under this, normally, before this change in the Tea Act, the tea sold in London by the East India Company would be put up at auction. Mm. Merchants from all over the world would attend these auctions where they could bid on large shipments of tea. And the bidding was a very raucous affair, in fact. As the auctioneer would light a small candle, and as the candle burned down, the merchants would be allowed to place their bids for the entire shipment. And when the candle had burned out entirely, whichever merchant had placed the largest bid would win. It's quite a tradition in London. Unfortunately, with the revision of the Tea Act, Parliament has been given jurisdiction over the East India Company, and they have decided not to put up for auction some of the most recent shipments of tea. In fact, the tea sitting in Boston Harbor currently was not put up for sale at the London auction.
Despite going bankrupt almost, the East India Company has acquired a surplus of tea over the years. This surplus is now surmounted about 17 million pounds in weight in London warehouses. That's quite a lot of tea, my friends. Not to mention, this expired tea will not be sold in London, as those in Parliament who have stakes in the East India Company feel it's better to send it off to us here in the American colonies. They say in Parliament that we won't know the difference between good tea and expired tea.
And I doubt that Lord North would even be able to taste his own fine teas through all the cream he puts into his cups.
Oh, Dot, my goodness.
Now, Dolly, I should point out that, you know, we shouldn't be drinking tea quite so publicly with all of the boycotts going on. Yes, tea has been boycotted publicly in Boston since 1767, back when the first taxes were placed on it.
Oh, and I hear that some women have been brewing their tea in coffee pots, my goodness, or sneaking into back rooms, sipping their tea secretly, rooms with not quite so many windows.
There are a lot of windows in here, aren't there?
Oh, goodness.
All right, everyone watch yourselves. Now, of course, there are alternatives to tea. Mm-hmm. If you want to keep the social custom of having tea available without having to drink specific East India Company tea. Mm. We mentioned coffee and cocoa already, though these are also imports and are expensive in their own right. But they are not being taxed in the same way that the East India Company tea is. But if you really want to turn to an entirely patriotic, homegrown solution, you will have to have a Liberty tea.
Oh.
Which is really just a nice way of saying boiling anything you can find in your garden or orchard that adds a little color and flavor to hot water. Mm. There are nice herbs you can use, peppermint and chamomile, catnip tea. Has not at all the same effect on humans as it does on cats. It's just good for the digestion.
Oh, well, whatever your flavor of tea might be, my friends, we do ask that you know the source of where it comes from. We can account on the Hutchinson boys and Richard Clark and Sons to let us know the source of the tea and that it's a quality tea coming into town. I have heard that some have been taking their used black tea leaves and drying them out, mixing them with ash and sheep's dung, and reselling it on the market. Friends, this is highly frowned upon for obvious reasons. And green tea as well is being mixed. We call this smooch, this used, disgusting tea that they are reselling. Green tea leaves, though, are expected to have a blue tinge to them, as those in China, when they are gathering the green tea leaves, will often mix it with blue metallic powders.
So, whether you want to swear off drinking tea for political or dietary reasons,
yes.
You should know that you will not be alone in this. In the last few years, as we mentioned, many people have joined the non-importation, non-consumption of tea. Mm. In fact, just in 1770 here in Boston, 300 women publicly signed a petition stating that they would not buy or drink any tea until the taxes had been repealed. For a woman to use her name publicly for a political matter was unprecedented. Mm-hmm. But this sort of movement is catching on like wildfire.
Or like tea, perhaps. Mm. I wonder if our teapot and our teacups will soon be filled with salt water instead of cream.
That might be interesting. Mm-hmm. As the poem A Lady's Adieu to Her Tea Table says,
no more shall my teacup so generous be in filling the cups with this pernicious tea, for I'll fill it with water and drink out the same before I lose liberty, that dearest name.
Because I am taught and believe it is fact that our ruin is aimed at in the late act mm-hmm. of imposing a duty on all foreign teas, which detestable stuff
Dot.
We can quit when we please.
Oh,
liberty's the goddess that I do adore, and I'll maintain her right until my last hour. Before she shall part, I will die with the cause, for I will never be governed by tyranny's laws.
Hear, hear.
Well,
thank you so much for joining us. We would like to open the floor now to any questions you might have.
You mentioned that the tea came to the colonies in boxes lined with lead to
yes.
make them waterproof. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the tea that was thrown into the harbor did not get wet. Was it recovered?
That's a very good question. It's why the men on the ships had to take hatchets and hack open each chest, dumping the loose leaf tea into the harbor. For if they had just thrown the crates into the harbor, their work would be done far easier. However, the tea chest could be reclaimed.
So when it comes to it, of course, we are a few days shy of perhaps the necessary destruction of the tea. It will mm-hmm. be a greater act of labor using these axes to smash mm-hmm. the crates open. But that's mm-hmm. a very good idea,
very
something
good
to
question.
Be taken into account.
When did they start adding cream, and did they ever add lemon?
Oh,
Now, cream was being added pretty much as soon as tea started to be consumed by English tea drinkers. Mm-hmm. Now, there were, in the very early days of tea drinking, a lot of people were quite confused about exactly how to brew it because it didn't come with instructions. They just heard of a mysterious leafy brew that called tea. You boil it somehow and then enjoy its beneficial qualities. But fairly quickly, it was discovered that a little bit of cream or milk would ease the flavor.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that, Dot. I have a funny anecdote for you. Mm. We heard of a family in the early days of tea being consumed here in the colonies. A family up in Salem, Massachusetts. They had acquired about a pound of tea and did not know what quite to do with it. As you said, there were no instructions with it. So they boiled the tea leaves for over an hour, making it a bit of a sludge. And as they drained the liquid and drank this very bitter liquid, they then took the leaves out and buttered them and ate them.
They poured off most of the liquid in which it had been brewed and ate some soaked, buttered, salted tea leaves. And you asked about lemon as well. Now, lemons had been an import to Boston for quite some time.
Yes, actually in 1770, about 2 million lemons were imported here into Boston town.
So while we do not have accounts specifically at hand of adding lemon to tea tables, lemons mm-hmm. were a very popular commodity in Boston, and being consumed as so large as they were, it is mm-hmm. not unreasonable to think that perhaps a wedge or two might have been put into a teacup here and there.
I quite like lemon in my tea.
You were talking about that there is some in the Middle East, I believe, where they drank tea from tea bricks,
they would brew
it with a certain type of milk.
Yak's milk.
Yak, okay,
right.
That was what I missed. Okay.
The tea brick could actually be used as currency over there as well, as it's yeah. easily transportable, but it hadn't quite caught on here in the colonies, as it's not the best quality tea when it's in brick form.
I wondered if the lead lining had any health effects on people who drank the tea.
Almost certainly, but considering that lead is used to line many foodstuffs, is often in cosmetics, in medicines, it's really hard to differentiate exactly what any lead poisoning from tea drinking would have been when separated from all of the other lead poisoning that the peoples of the 18th century.
So many choices.
Exactly.
How do you take your lead? perhaps a little bit of lemon with it.
Exactly. Nicely. A little sweeter, smoother to go down.
Was tea safer to drink than water because it was boiled?
Well, Benjamin Franklin does say that water has a bit of bacteria in it. I suppose if you boil your water hot enough, maybe it will rid itself of any...
We have caught on to drinking water that's been boiled seems to have less health effects than drinking just plain water from any sources you might find at a, you know, room temperature or spring temperature. Mm. Especially the water in any urban areas can be quite dirty. In fact,
New York actually has made specific tea wells for water, where if you would like to drink some tea, you can go to the tea well, get some water to be brewed, and that well is specifically used for tea only.
Particularly clean. Mm-hmm. But you are right. Other than in hotter states, it is very uncommon for people to drink just plain water. It is considered an abnormality and a way to encourage further disease.
Though tea is good for your health, it's said to cure colds, scurvy, if you're around
heaviness,
giddiness.
That's right. All manners of infirmity.
Yes, expelleth infection quite well.
Can tea be made from the bricks, and if so, how?
Can it be made from the bricks?
Tea, our style of tea can be made from the bricks. However, as the bricks had not been imported into the colonies at this point, it wouldn't be exactly 18th century colonial tea. What you would do is you take the brick and often a knife and scratch off a small amount of the dusty tea. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, as this is a dusty tea and not the loose leaves, it will create a bit of a sludgier mixture in your cup because it's very fine and crumpled. Mm-hmm. You can boil it with a normal amount of water. Again, since it's sludge, you might have a more difficult time separating the tea leaves from it.
Yes. It's not exactly the best quality tea they're putting in brick form as well.
Right.
It's usually the base and the bottom of the stalk of the plant that they're using, any of those dead leaves that have oxidized to the point of rotting.
Mm-hmm. Now, did men also partake in tea, or did they prefer other stronger beverages?
Both. Men did partake in tea, typically at breakfast. That would be normally had with the entire family, and the entire family would drink tea. A lot of men really did enjoy the taste of tea, but many men also imbibed stronger spirits as well. Now, most people were drinking a low alcohol cider or ale on a regular basis, men, women, children alike. But as for things like imported liquors, these would be the men's world. And typically in the after-dinner crowd, they would go more towards alcohol, while women would go more towards tea.
Mm-hmm. That Hyson tea we mentioned earlier is a favorite of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, in fact. And I suppose, since rum is a great trade here in Boston, you could put a little rum in your tea and just don't tell anyone.
That's exciting. All right. And I think that's just about time for us, is it?
Thank you so much for
joining
us. Yes,
thank you all.
John Hancock's uncle Thomas smuggled Dutch tea into the country to sell to British Army and Navy. In Liquid Jade, the story of tea from east to west, Beatrice Hoheneger writes that more than half of all the tea consumed was being smuggled.